I pushed the record button. This is Ham Radio Now, episode number 410, ElmerCast episode 1, and we'll talk about that in a minute. I'm David Goldenberg, W0DHG. Thanks for joining me tonight, and I have two guests tonight, and as you saw, the show title tonight is From the Ground Up, and it is a play on words, and we're doing something new with ElmerCast. We are starting to add some educational shows. We want to dig into some ham radio topic every couple weeks. It won't be every show. It'll be every other show, every third show, depending on how many guests I get. And we'll look at a topic, and then we'll give you some opportunities after the show's over to ask for some more information or provide some feedback, and then we may dig into it further and further as we go on. I will now introduce my guests. Tonight I have two guests tonight. We'll start with Jim Aspinwall, N01PC. I got it right. Hi, Jim.
Yay. Hi, David. Welcome to ElmerCast number one. We did a little intro a couple of weeks ago, just talking about our subject matter and what we want to bring to the audience before. And by way of introduction, I'm the forum leader on Facebook of a group called Amateur Radio Elmers, which I started about almost 4 years ago now. We're almost 4,200 members. And the premise is a very fair, open, educational forum for hams of all ages from all over the world to come and ask questions, get proper answers, qualify what people know and want to know about the hobby and how to make the most of it. It's one of many social forums for amateur radio, but we're trying to stay on point of, you have questions, we'll have answers, whether anybody in the forum has got the answer or we have to go off and dig. And we have a lot of the same questions there as you'll find at almost any other place. But we want to dig into the expertise behind the answers, not just simply saying, well, here, push this button or get this piece of wire and it'll solve your problem. Let's take that problem as a learning opportunity, be it power supplies or type of antenna, style of coax connector, where to get power in your mobile, your new Honda car for mobile operation, those kinds of things. And let's not just answer the question, say, drill the hole here, run the coax, and you're done. But why we drill the hole there, why we're using one piece of coax or something or the other. So that's kind of an embellishment of what we're building on, what we've been building up in the last 4 years. And I said, let's take this to another level. We've had a lot of collaborators, a lot of good contributors in the group. I've got a tremendous resource of broadcast commercial resources to bring to the to back up what we're doing here. And that's sort of where we're going tonight, is to reach out to other experts in our hobby and in technical fields, even into these, maybe some of the served agencies and NGOs and things we volunteer for as we go out and talk about field operations, bring that expertise to bear front and center, and let it strengthen your confidence in that there are good answers out there, there's sound practice, and that's what we're going to continue to do. So there'll be a little initiative going on here to start with that I call the Elmer University, which is not going to be a school per se, but I want to envision a bunch of adjunct professors, contributors, peer reviewers, looking at the subject matter, helping us index it, cross-index it to what it applies to, because just one subject in amateur radio usually touches on three or four other aspects. So let's share that. And to that, our first esteemed guest is Ward Silver. I sought Ward out for his expertise in grounding systems, thus the play on words. A lot of things we do on our ham shack need to start with a good foundation. And a lot of problems that arise in the ham shack are usually go to ground pretty quickly. So have I played that enough? So to that, I'll let Ward introduce himself, and then we're going to get into the topic.
Okay, thanks, Jim. Glad to be on the show. And it's a big topic of interest these days, grounding and all that. My background is electrical engineer. I spent couple decades plus in the product development and field and field service and field development jobs, or medical, industrial, that kind of thing. And then went into educating, teaching at college level and stuff. And then drifted into writing and editing for the ARRL. I do the handbook. I'm the lead editor. I do the antenna book, also lead editor, and the three license manuals. So if you've used one of the ARRL license manuals, I guess I'm your guy. And that's been a very rewarding field for me. I also got tabbed to write this book. A little commercial plug here. Ham Radio for Dummies, now in its third major edition. And that's sort of a desktop Elmer for everybody that's trying to get their license or just got it and they want to know now what. That's the book for that. So I guess germane to the show, a couple of years ago, I was writing a column for QST every month called Hands-On Radio. And I wrote one called The Myth of RF Ground. And it generated so much correspondence, the most in 16 years of writing the column. And I said, well, I need another column. So I wound up writing three on the subject, January, February, and March of 2016, I think. And there was so much interest in that. I said, you know, we really need to capture this, the basic principles and practices in some kind of a reference for hams. And so that's where this book came from. This is the grounding and bonding book. And it covers a lot of the stuff that covers all the stuff we're going to talk about tonight and in depth. So it's sort of the follow-up. And then Jim got a hold of me and asked me to come on the show and talk about grounding. I've given presentations on this to a number of audiences, from basic general club groups all the way up to almost neo-engineering groups, and I haven't been run out of town on a rail yet, so I guess I must be doing something okay. So here we are this evening to talk about grounding and bonding and all sorts of things.
Well, very good. Well, the fountain of knowledge. I was not aware of the whole background of your contributions to the ARRL, but now I know where everybody learns things. So this is a pretty proud moment for the group here. Welcome. So we talked a little bit earlier about how deep we're going to go, and as we start from the ground up again, what is ground? Let's just talk about some of the basics of what we realize is actual ground and what we call ground and why it is or isn't.
Okay. Well, the first thing you have to do when you start dealing with ground is control the meanings of the words that you use. I've participated in conversations with people who were busily talking about ground, and they thought they were communicating, and after a few sentences, it became pretty obvious that they were both talking about completely different things, but they used the same word, and so that's where we get into confusion a lot. And ground means different things at different frequencies or different applications, and for different purposes. I think the three major areas where we get into ground in amateur radio is, first and foremost, is the safety, the AC safety grounding, and that's the domain of the electricians, and there's an extensive body of work on that, and a lot of safety practices and principles that you should be aware of. Then there's the whole lightning protection thing, which is a very wide spectrum use of the word. Lightning goes from DC up to several megahertz. So you have aspects that overlap with AC safety, and then you get all the way up into the RF realm. And then there's this RF ground concept, which is really kind of a myth. The quote that comes to mind is from K9YC, he says, ground is not a magic sink into which we can pour RF currents and have them all magically disappear. It just doesn't work that way. So I try to avoid using the term RF ground and get instead to direct the conversation into this concept called bonding, and we'll touch on that several times through the presentation. And the book, the grounding and bonding book, is about half about bonding. And bonding sounds really expensive, but all it really means is to connect two things together to keep them at the same voltage. And there are lots of ways to do that. And so I'll keep coming back to bonding as we go through the various topics. So to get to the second part of the question is, why is it important? Well, obviously for safety, you want to make sure that with this collection of equipment, you operate it in such a way that you won't shock yourself or somebody else, and you want to make sure that you survive the experience. So we follow safety principles. We are supposed to anyway. And these are relatively well defined. As for lightning protection, if you live in an area of the country where lightning is common, and I live in the Midwest, so Mr. Lightning comes for a visit regularly, the guys in Florida, the hams down there, they know Mr. Lightning very, very well. He comes pretty much every afternoon about 4 o'clock in some places in Florida. So protecting your equipment and all the other stuff in the house, the electronics from damage from lightning, is important. And so that's a bit more subtle topic than just, hey, connect these things together. So there are some columns on that, QST, you can look at. We've got some stuff in the book. And then the idea of how do you manage this RF floating around your shack through bonding and various other techniques is very important, because we want to avoid getting RFI. We want to avoid bad signals. We want to avoid getting burned by an RF signal on the mic. And why is it always right on the end of your nose where you get an RF burn? That's one of the rites of passage of AM radio, is your first RF burn. And so you can basically start from these basic concepts and build up a toolbox of things that you know work in different situations. So then when you go out field day, or you start rewiring your shack or something like that, you have this these tools and these materials, and you know how to use them to make something that doesn't have problems with safety, protects itself reasonably well against lightning and other disturbances, and exposes you to a minimum amount of trouble with RFI. So that's kind of the answer to that question. A lot more questions.
And there would be more questions. Yeah, well, that's it's very interesting that you've broken it into the three areas of focus, which will come together. I sort of refer to it, probably erroneously, as the station ground system, to try and capture and encompass all three. Not that that in itself is a whole practice or an absolute practice, because as you say, RF is going to behave differently depending on what you're doing with it, in context to your home safety system. But I suspect that we want them, as you say, to bring everything to the same non-harmful potential for humans and other things to that we're going to be exposed to. And I think we're all, I grew up in the Midwest. Lightning was one of our nemesis, whether we realized it or not. Before we knew about, before we had third wire grounds in our homes, before Dad knew to ground the antenna, I guess everybody thought, let's just disconnect the coax and put a clip lead on it. And we've taken care of the lightning mitigation on our dipoles and things. And sometimes that's not true. I've had some intimate experience with the damage of lightning. I'll hold up my my tower climbing good luck charm. This goes in my climbing bag. This is from 1,500 feet of commercial television feed line from a lightning and ice storm in 1976 in Wisconsin. And a very ambitious tower climber had to climb 1,500 feet of that tower and empty these 20-foot copper pipes and replace, I think there's probably six or eight of these in every 20-foot section of copper pipes. So there's quite a pile of these things on the ground. For reference, that's a half-inch thick piece of Teflon. And if you can imagine the energy it takes to do that, that's, you know, that's what we're trying to mitigate, or at least avoid, in lightning, and probably won't do a very good job in most of our ham situations.
If you brought up.
Well, yeah, Mr. Lightning, I like to say, he will come for a visit, and you can't really steer Mr. Lightning, but you can help him make good decisions.
Excellent way of putting it.
So one of the things you brought up was the third wire ground, right? So we're all familiar with that. You know, I've got a plug at home, and it might have two prongs. You know, there's the hot and the neutral, or there might be that third one, and that grounds it out. And ideally, somewhere back at the panel, there's a copper rod piled into the ground, and that keeps everything in the house safe, right? When we talk about it from a ham radio perspective, it should keep things safe, right? It's a hope.
Yeah.
But when we talk about it from the ham radio's perspective, is that the same ground that we're hoping to use? So, like, I know on my Yaesu FTDX 3000, it's 12 volts, right? And there is a wing net and a place to put a ground wire. Should I be grounding that to that center conductor or finding another place? And again, remember, everybody, I'm the new ham here.
Well, let me point out that there's you don't have to have three different ground systems. Okay. You have one ground system to rule them all. It's sort of like with the ring. Yep. If you build a ground system and all currents flow on all wires, if an AC safety fault current, for example, say you have a short circuit inside a piece of equipment, and suddenly that amperage wants to go someplace, it's not going to go to some junction someplace and go, oh, I can't flow on that wire, that's a lightning ground. Or I can't flow on that wire, that goes out to the antenna system. It will flow wherever it wants. And so by building one reasonably solid ground system that satisfies the requirements, you can see my engineering background here. If you satisfy the requirements for AC safety and lightning protection and RF management, then one system will do the job for all of them. And you don't have to build three. Now, your question about, the safety conductor and stuff like that, let's back up there a little bit. And so why are there different types of ground? Well, they have different functions. And let's just start with the AC safety ground, because I think people are very familiar with that. The AC safety ground has two functions, only two. One is to provide a solid path back to the common point of your AC power system, which is inside your main circuit box, for fault currents. And it's supposed to keep those fault currents from going through you. And it's supposed to be a heavy enough conductor that it will trip whatever circuit protection you have in that box, whether it's a circuit breaker or a fuse or whatever. It's supposed to carry that fault current long enough to make that protective element remove power from the afflicted circuit. That's its major function. And the other function is simply to stabilize the power system voltage in the case of a transient, like a lightning strike somewhere, or maybe there's a fault from a tree falling into a line, or Joe Bob drives his pickup into a power pole and knocks the power pole over or something like that. If you go out and you look at your power poles, most of them will have what's called a butt connection to the earth, where you see the wire come down the pole and then it's wrapped around the bottom of the pole in the dirt. And by itself, that's not a particularly good ground connection, but there are thousands and thousands and thousands of them. So in parallel, they help tie the voltage of the AC power system to the earth, and that helps keep the power system from going to crazy voltages when these things happen. So that's the only two functions of that that ground connection. And the primary one that you're concerned with is keeping fault currents away from you. So the ground connection that's connected to your enclosures, and yes, you should connect every piece of equipment in the shack with exposed metal on it, even the ones that don't have power, should be connected to the AC safety ground system through a third wire connection that's connected to the enclosure, or maybe a ground wire that you attach to it and then tie it to some convenient ground point. And that's basically the AC safety system. You can have three wires on your 120-volt AC here in the United States. Inside that cable, you'll have a neutral and you'll have a ground. And the power is supplied between the hot wire and the neutral. And then the ground wire is your protective. If you trace it all the way back to the panel and you take it off the cover and you look inside the scary part where all the wiring is, you'll see two buses, one with all the white wires from all your branch circuits going back to this, what they call the neutral bus. And bus is just a common connection. And then all the green wires or the bare copper wires will be connected to some other bus. And then there'll be this big jumper between them. And that's called your main bonding jumper. And that's the point at which the AC power system is tied to your safety ground. And from that ground bus, you'll see a big fat ground wire that goes outside the house someplace. And that's primarily how all modern houses are wired. And if you trace that wire out, you'll go to a ground rod, or maybe you have an oofer ground, also called concrete encased ground, where you use the rebar in your somewhat conductive concrete to make a big concrete ground rod, is basically what you're doing. That's popular in dry areas like in New Mexico, parts of Texas, out in the desert. Every place else uses ground rods. And the standard now is to use two ground rods, but let's just call that the earth connection. So that's your AC safety ground system. It's all of the current paths that come from the enclosures and exposed metal back through this third wire ground. And depending on where you are in the country, it'll be called third wire ground, equipment safety ground, green wire ground. And they all go back to your main service panel where they're connected to the common point of the AC power. And that's basically, it's the law. That's code in almost every place in the United States. And I'll just put it in an aside there. If you're concerned about what is the law and what is required, then you need to find out who the authority having jurisdiction is. Sometimes you'll see that abbreviated AHJ, Alpha Hotel Japan, authority having jurisdiction. That's your local building department and your codes. They specify what you may and may not and must not do. And so you need to follow those. Those are usually based on the National Electrical Code, the NEC, but there can be regional variations for whatever reason, either because of ground conditions or some way this power system is. Follow that recommendation. That's not put there just to make your life difficult. It's to extend your life by making the wiring practices safe. So follow the code and do that on your AC safety system. So that's AC safety ground. I've talked about that for quite a while now. So I'll turn it back to Jim.
Good, good. Well, that hits a nail on the head. And then we got to the ground rod, but we're actually putting it in the earth. So there's, I see where the rebar situation in dry territories, we can talk about earth conductivity. You know, and a lot of people think that, you know, Mother Earth is 0 ohms and is the big current carrying conductor of the universe. And
Nope.
Out here in California, we've got everything from dry desert, a million ohms sand to maybe 200 ohms between ground rods in my backyard.
Right.
Yeah, Jim. Do you have a rod at your place, Jim? Because I know when we first moved in, it was on the cold water pipe coming in from the service, and then when we remodeled, they put a ground rod in.
Well, right. they tried that. This house was built in 1953 with cast iron pipe coming from I think it was cast iron coming from the water meter in the street. Not sure that was a ground reference at all, but I do see from my service entrance panel a piece of probably number 8 bare copper running about 25 feet around the side of the house to that water pipe.
Yeah.
And I said, there should be a ground rod right here under the breaker box. I'm going to put one in and strap down to that. And I remember when we had the plumbing redone, the water main feed redone, it was done in PVC. And I told the guys, before you cut that metal pipe, let me get this other ground down here so the water, you don't get between, you know, whatever's going to happen in my house and the water meter and be the lightning rod, so to speak. So we've done that. And we have a branch panel feeding our garage about 150 feet away from the entrance panel. I added ground there, but that's part of what I'll call the station ground. And Ward is going to educate me how to fix this if it needs it. There is a ground at the tower as well. So I've at least followed as much of NEC I can to bring those all together to the same potential as much as possible.
Right. The important thing on external ground connections is to bond them all together. You don't want to depend on the earth to be the conductor for any kind of hazard current and fault current. Even in good soil conductivity areas, if you go drive two ground rods into the soil that are, 20, 30, 50 feet apart, and then you measure the resistance between them, you'll get 5, 10, 25, 50, 100 ohms. And if you are talking about a fault current of several amps, or if you're talking about a lightning transient that can be upwards of hundreds of amps, of kiloamps, I don't know about you, but the idea of kiloamp transients is a little scary. I studied milliamp level stuff in school, and so kiloamps makes me nervous. But anyway, you can't depend on the earth as your what's called a unipotential surface. It just doesn't work that way. So wherever you drive in ground rods, at your tower, at a sub building, for example, and there are special rules about that, look in your NEC handbook about what to do with sub panels, either inside your main residence or like in a garage or out in an outbuilding. If you've been banished to an outbuilding from your shack and you put in a special circuit breaker box out there, there are certain rules for doing that make it safe. So look those up. Anyway, bond everything together. You want to use something like number 6 AWG copper and use the right clamps and all that kind of stuff and bond them all together so that they're all one big common earth terminal. And outside your circuit breaker box is where the main ground, the earth connection is, should be. And Jim brings up a real good point. Back in the day, you could use plumbing as your ground connection because it was all copper. And so copper would go through the foundation and run out to the street. There were copper pipes. They would connect to the cast iron water mains, all this kind of stuff. That is no longer the case. And inside relatively recent housing and all sorts of buildings, the plumbing is plastic. Even if it starts out as copper from, say, the water heater, that can switch to plastic somewhere in a wall. And all it takes is one little fitting someplace that's plastic, and you no longer have a continuous copper pipe. And it's also very common for water service to be replaced to older buildings. You may have a copper pipe coming in through the foundation into your water heater and stuff. And if you went out and dug it up, you'd find that a foot or two away from the house, it switches to plastic. So you cannot depend on that anymore as using your plumbing as a ground connection. Just don't. Use ground rods and bond them all together. That's a code requirement, and it's good practice. You install what's called a perimeter ground around your house, and every 10 feet or so you drive in a ground rod, you connect it to the ground wire that runs around your house, and that ties everything together. If you can do it, have the cable guy, the telephone guy, all these different services that come into your house, have them all come in close to the AC service panel and use that common ground connection. Otherwise, you wind up with one ground rod for the telephone guy. He puts that in. Mm-hmm. Then here comes your cable TV guy, and he puts another one in. And then one day you put up a TV antenna and you run your ground wire down to the ground like it tells you, but then you put in a separate ground wire there, and then you've got one over where your feed lines come into the house, and all the those are connected together with is dirt, okay? And dirt isn't very conductive, so you want to bond all that stuff together and create a perimeter ground, and that gives you a real good outside earth connection.
Right, and you get, you know, and it, going back to a 1953 house, you can imagine that there wasn't a ground wire in the power lead, and something like my rotor controller back here probably didn't have a ground lead in it. If that transformer is leaking or not the chassis right, you know, you can get 60 or 70 volts on chassis just from it in induced voltage in the transformer. There's some of these devices that I think some of the old radio sets actually took 120 or at the time 110 out of the wall, rectified it right there in the chassis, and if you plugged it in backwards, you know, the chassis was connected to the black wire.
Hot. Yeah.
Yeah, talk about a hot mic.
We'll survive that, but yeah, you know, well, life expectancy used to be about 55, you know, so there are reasons for this, but yeah, we know a lot more about that now. You have to be very careful with vintage equipment for that reason. And vintage wiring and vintage plumbing are also potentially a problem as well.
Yeah. So I'm going to venture a little bit out from the shack because I've done all the hard bonding, and you've got drawings, I've got drawings of how to do this grounding bonding of chassis to our ground source, not leaping through. I've probably made that mistake a couple of times, and we'll touch on RFI probably a little later on or in another episode of what allows RFI to exist and those kind of conditions. But yeah, everything back here, even though everything but the KWM2 and the rotor box are on 12 volts, everybody's got a green wire that goes down to the copper bus on the floor. So if anything happens, it's going to sink to there, safety or otherwise at that point, which is very important. Because again, if the KWM2 chassis decides to float and it was ground looped over to my flex, SDR, then I'd end up with a hot flex chassis and probably kill that little microprocessor in there.
Oh, there's lots of ways to kill microprocessors, trust me. I tell you what, let's run through the lightning protection idea here and introduce the idea of bonding, and then we'll get to RFI because it's a natural progression from low frequency AC safety stuff through lightning protection into the black arts of RF. And I won't get into the lightning protection too much. I'll suggest that you go to Ron Block, is one of the guys that founded Polyphaser, and he wrote three articles with QST in 2002 on lightning protection, and those are available at arrl.org/safety, and they're available to everybody, not just ARL members. Go read those three articles, and Ron was a reviewer of the grounding and bonding book and had a lot to contribute. So he explains the science of lightning protection. And if you have lightning in your area, this might be a good thing. There it is on the screen to show you what it looks like, what you're looking for in the ARL site. So anyway, the idea in the station, in the shack, to protect you against damage from lightning. And I always caution people to get the heck out of the shack. If there's lightning around, you know, you can do a really good job on bonding and protecting all your equipment, but I still wouldn't trust that kind of thing. And the basic idea is to just go someplace else that's not connected to antennas and lightning attractors while there's a lightning storm going on. Don't try to operate through it. There are pros that can do this. Most of us are not pros. So let's move on from that. But the idea is to bond all of your equipment together. Remember, it's just connecting them together so they all stay at the same voltage. And if you've ever gone out to a lake or a river or something like that, and you see boats tied to a dock. Frequently, the dock floats. The boats are tied to the dock, but the dock goes up and down. And the reason it does that is so that when a big wave comes by for one of those big yachts that's out there going a lot faster than it's supposed to, and you get this big wave that comes in, or maybe there's a lot of rain and a lake or reservoir fills up. If you had that dock tied down firmly, what would happen is that wave or the rising water level would tear the dock apart, or it would break your boats away from the dock, and then you'd have all these problems. The idea is to let everything go up and down together. And it's the same thing electrically. When that transient comes through your shack, you want everything to go up and down together. You keep it all at the same voltage. And that means there's no destructive voltages between equipment A and equipment B that would cause an arc or a heavy current or something like that. That's what kills interfaces and microprocessors and things like that. Suddenly there's a big transient, and suddenly the cable that's supposed to be having no more than 5 volts on it suddenly might have 100 volts on it. And a big transient can induce a whole lot of voltage. Now we're talking about inductance instead of resistance. In AC safety, you're concerned mostly about low resistance. But when you start talking about RF, and lightning is substantially RF, and a very fast rising transient, then it doesn't take very much inductance to cause a big current, a big voltage transient. The voltage across an inductance is equal to the inductance times the rate of change of the current. And these lightning transients change in thousands of amps per microsecond. So even a nanohenry of inductance can result in hundreds of volts. A straight piece of wire, number 12 wire, about a foot long, that gets a big transient through it can have over 1,000 volts from end to end. That's a straight wire. There's no coils, there's no bends or anything else. So the important thing is to connect things together with short, low inductance connections. And you can do that directly. You can connect all the pieces of equipment from one to the other with heavy wire, like number 14. That's a good application for all that junk Romex that you save from the wiring project that you refuse to throw away because you might need it someday. Well, this is a particularly good application. That number 14 wire is excellent for this. You can connect the equipment directly together, but that's kind of inconvenient when you want to replace one piece. So the standard in the handbook going back decades has been to put some kind of a bus in the back of your shelf, your equipment shelf, or on your desk. And usually it's a piece of copper pipe or something. And they show all of the equipment grounds connected to that piece of pipe. And that serves to bond the equipment together. And you can pull out the equipment, you can pull it out and work on it and put it back in, that sort of stuff. But you want to have short, direct connections between all of the pieces of equipment. And what I suggest to people is that they think of the entire shack as part of your antenna system, because it really is. If you go out and you look at it from the perspective of your antenna, probably your antenna is in your backyard. So how far is it away? 50 feet? 100 feet, something like that. And if we're talking about 80 meters, 40 meters, 20 meters, that's just within a wavelength or two of the antenna. So you're all sitting there right in the near field, and every piece of wire, every piece of metal in that shack, from your headphones and microphone all the way to the output connector, that's part of your antenna system. The waves are going to come in. They don't care that's a piece of equipment. That's just a conductor. So they're going to induce voltages on that and currents. And so what causes current to flow? Voltage. So if you have different voltages at different points in your shack, then that'll cause current to flow between them. And that's where RFI starts to happen, caused by your transmitted signal. There are multiple kinds of RFI too, which is another subject we can talk about in a different show. But basically treat everything in your shack as one big piece of wiring that's part of your antenna system. And you want to make sure that all of your equipment is tied together so that, again, it all goes up and down together so that when you key up on 40 meter phone, something like that, and you've got the dipole in the backyard is radiating stuff and it's being picked up on the, all the wires in your shack, you want all of that equipment to go up and down together. If it does, then there's no voltage between this piece and this piece, and so it won't cause current flow between them. And the current is what causes the RFI. That's what causes the buzz or the hums or the thumps. And by tying everything together, you also don't have hot spots. Everything's all at the same voltage. So your D104 doesn't knock you for a loop when you key up and you bend over and you touch it to your nose and all of a sudden you're flat on your back behind the shack chair and the cat's looking at you going, what's the matter with you? Well, you tie everything together, then you won't have that problem. And so that's basically the approach you need to take in the shack for what's called RF grounding. Isn't really RF grounding at all. It's just RF management. You're not going to get rid of it. There is no zero voltage point for RF. All you've got is a common point. And if you are at the same voltage as everything else, there's no shocks, no hotspots, no current flowing between your digital interface and your computer or between the computer and the control input of your radio and all that kind of stuff. So basically everything, think of it as a floating dock. It all goes up and it goes down together and it just behaves itself.
So absolutely. Absolutely great point. And I especially like the leave the shack. You know, anybody who's familiar with a video of a Tesla coil is got some idea of what a million volts is going to do running around a room. And that's what people have seen happen in their shacks is, you know, if they haven't taken these measures, or even if they have, because a large enough strike can induce that that kind of potential. And I can see we can do a little sub bit about lightning, and I don't want to do that here because you mentioned polyphaser, and Ron is one of my intended guests just to talk about those kinds of features, because that is a whole tricky situation. You've got static buildup. Everybody, you know, has their own way of thinking how lightning occurs and why it occurs, and that's a whole topic on its own. But certainly mitigating the differences in the shack and what we can with RF is one thing. And I know that a lot of people will say I've pounded a pole in the ground for to put up my J pole or hang a little Yagi or a ground plane. Is that not grounded enough with that mast? Or I put a ground rod at the base of the mast, I tied them together, my coax runs from my ground plane right into the shack. What have I done wrong in this if I haven't followed, if I didn't know any better?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, you haven't done anything wrong. You may just not have done enough things right. So, yes, you're required to ground any metal support structure. That's standard code. And that is basically to give Mr. Lightning a low impedance path to Earth if he comes to visit and hits your tower or whatever. And it doesn't even have to be a direct hit. It can be what's called an induced strike from something nearby. You have so much energy in these strikes that it's not just within the lightning bolt itself. It's also in the space around the lightning bolt. The magnetic fields are quite high. So basically, sure, ground your tower, ground your mast, whatever. Even a TV mast on the chimney is supposed to have a number 8 wire run down to a ground rod. Okay, fine. Now, tie that to the rest of the ground rods that are outside the house and create yourself what's called a single point grounding panel where everything comes in to the station. If you're fortunate and maybe you're building a new house or you have a choice about where to put the shack and all this kind of stuff, if you can cause all of your feed lines to go in and out of the structure at the same point that your telephone and your cable TV and your AC stuff do, then you can tie all those grounds together very, very easily. They're all right there. And that helps prevent differences in grounds. that you talked about, that big arc in the shack or, you know, in your house, people say, oh, there was a lightning strike and I saw this big arc go from the TV to my computer and neither one of them works anymore. Well, right, because the grounds were not tied together well enough. And so this big voltage was developed between the TV and the computer enough to cause this arc to jump between them. Well, if you can tie all the grounds together where they come into the house, that's the best solution. If you can't do that, then you create the perimeter ground with a ground rod here, and a ground rod here, and a ground rod here, and they're all tied together with this heavy wire outside. Okay, so your single point ground panel, we've seen pictures of that. Maybe it is really a panel. Maybe it is an aluminum or copper panel that's had a cutout where it goes into the house, and you've got your feed through connectors on there, and you've got your lightning arrestors and a real heavy ground rod right outside. Just make sure that's tied into all of your other ground rods outside as part of your perimeter ground system. Just think floating dock. Everything goes up and down together, and you keep your single point stuff together. And I want to make a point here, so to speak, about single point. If you talk to an electrician, single point to them means a place where all of the electrical connections are made together so that they're not daisy chained from one piece of equipment to another. Well, that's great. Those guys work at 50 or 60 hertz, maybe up to a few hundred hertz in three-phase systems where you're talking about harmonics and other things. The wavelength at those frequencies is extremely long. At 60 hertz, it's something like 50,000 meters. I keep forgetting the number. It's so big. In which case, a football stadium is a single point ground. What you're talking about is an electrically small connection so that there's very low impedance between all of the connections to that point. Well, at 50 or 60 hertz, that can be a size of a football field and still be electrically small in terms of a wavelength. So when they talk about single point ground, sure, star ground, you just basically run your cables all over to this one point. And that's basically what a circuit breaker box has inside of it, is a single point ground. All of the branch circuits bring their grounds to this one single point. Okay, that's great at AC. But when you start talking about RF, the wavelength gets a lot smaller. And so anything that's a certain size can be wildly different sizes at different frequencies. At 20 meters, for example, gee, the wavelength's, 20 meters. And so that's 60-something feet. If you want to keep your single point ground to something within that's less than a tenth of a wavelength or a 20th of a wavelength, then you're talking about maybe something like 3, 4, 5, 6 feet, and not a football stadium. So your single point has shrunk quite a bit. So to work at RF, you want your single point, in that case, single point, to be an electrically small point. So everything has to be close together. And that's why you talk about a single point panel. It's just maybe a couple feet by a couple feet. Keep it small, keep it short, keep it direct, low inductance, and you're good to go. And tie that into your perimeter ground system.
So you've described a panel that the coax should come through and meet a ground bond before it comes into the shack, which is right. A little different than back in my shortwave listening days before I got licensed, of grabbing a roll of hookup wire, stick it in a tree, and running it through the crack in the window in my bedroom and hooking it to the shortwave radio. And I suspect a lot of people still do that. This gets into antenna theory and what's an antenna. We'll still do that and try with a piece of RG58 from their mast. Yep. And just bring it into the bedroom and, you know, hook it up to 100 watt HF transceiver.
I've done it.
Yeah.
Absolutely. And we
sort
do
the 100 watts in a wire thing.
All that kind of stuff. And I want to back up a little bit and say, you know, you'll go through this process and you think and you worry about all this stuff. and you'll run into some ham and they'll always say, oh, I never did any of that stuff. And I was fine. Nothing happened to me. And yeah, probably nothing did. And I say that right in the intro to the book. I had no idea when I was just getting started out what this ground thing was. It just said, hey, there's a ground terminal, and by golly, you have to connect it to a ground rod. And so I did. I had no idea why. Sometimes the ground wire came off, and I had nothing bad happened to me. I'm still here. Sure, you can get away with all sorts of stuff. If the point of these discussions is to say, look, if you're really concerned about it, if you want to do it in a way that will avoid potential problems, here's how. You can disregard this advice, and we all know that you can wire up stuff to the AC supply in all sorts of strange ways, and maybe we've done it ourselves out in the garage because we were in a hurry and all this kind of stuff, and we got away with it. You can get away with stuff, sure, but if you want to know how to do it right, that's what this discussion is for.
Well, yeah, and we see a lot of this come up in the dialogue. Certainly, I didn't do that, and I'm fine. And those are the same guys that when somebody says, well, I just got my HF rig, and I'm running an NFED off my balcony, and, you know, my wife is complaining that there's squiggly lines on the TV. That doesn't quite happen anymore. We're dating myself. And, of course, their answer is, well, just get a bunch of chokes and put it on everything, and we'll cover that later. That's a whole nother mystery. But I can tell you a couple things from my experience, not that mine at Elmer's knew a whole lot about ground or what we're dealing with, even though they come from the KWM2 era. And the military never really addressed this, and this is where a lot of what has evolved for all of us is – you know, what goes on in a Navy ship, which is a different environment than a fast track with an Envis whip, and we'll go into those things too. I was working as a commercial engineer, a two-way engineer, for a company where I grew up, and also with a lot of hams that were into other things. We had engineering students that helped us build our repeaters and design controllers and these things. And one guy brought me into, because he knew I was involved in theater, said, you got to come over and see this broadcast, this recording studio we're building. We were building this whole op amp thing. It's no longer tubes and Mackies and, you know, whatever was going on back in the early 70s. And it was a phenomenal, nice 32-channel recording studio board and everything. And it was at the base of one of the local AM radio station towers. And I said, so how do you record here with 1510 AM at, you know, 5,000 watts above your head, or the base of the tower is lit up? And they said, well, we fought that when we first built this thing. And we came up with this this thing we call the multiplex ground bus. And I said, what's that? And he showed me the main ground on the back of the board, which was a piece of RG8. And the center conductor of the piece of RG8 was the ground, and the shield was pulled back. And he said, at the other end, the shield and the center are tied together out at the building ground, because we had to shield the ground rod, or the ground wire, because it was still getting AMRF into it. So that goes to the whole inductance. They didn't understand what they were doing at the time, but that goes into your whole thing about the inductance and how the resistance of a wire changes depending on what the signal is.
Yeah. If you've got a resonant ground wire, for example, this comes up. I want to back up a little bit, mention a couple of points. The military and the commercial environments, all that equipment is and systems are designed for the intended environment. The Navy ship is basically one big grounded panel that floats in salt water. Okay, if you're talking about a military vehicle, then everything's inside the vehicle. If you're talking about a man pack, then it's a kind of a floating sort of thing. But there's a bazillion dollars spent into designing that equipment to work in those environments. Hams don't have a bazillion dollars. Basically, the joke is about how do you make a small fortune? Well, you start with a large one and get into ham radio, okay? and we don't have that kind of money. So how do we make our stations work reasonably well with a high probability of success using the minimal amount of stuff? Instead of having a big fancy ground system with rack panels and overhead buses and all this kind of stuff, if you go look at the Motorola communication standard R56, yes, which is for communications facilities, if you have a bazillion dollars, okay, and you look at this stuff and you go, okay, I can't possibly do that, but you can see what they're trying to do.
Yes.
And you can kind of go, okay, well, how can I do that? Well, what I tell people is, look, just go get some flashing at the hardware store, some aluminum roofing flashing, and lay that down on the table before you put your equipment on it. Okay, what that creates is this big reference plane. The RF comes in and sees that and says, oh, one big flat low inductance contact here, and you bond everything to that. Maybe you put a pipe on top of it and you have your ground wires going to the pipe, but the pipe's right on this piece of aluminum flashing. And then basically it keeps everything at the same RF potential. And so you don't have 10 volts over here at 40 meters and 20 volts over here at 20 meters, all this kind of stuff. That's cheap. If you go out for field day, and you know, somebody brings a card table, somebody brings a radio, somebody brings a coffee pot, blah, 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 and you throw it all together. And we've all been through this. Oh my gosh, on 15 meters, everything lit up like crazy. You know, we couldn't operate on 15 meters unless you sit over here and you lift one foot and, you know, all this kind of stuff. Take some aluminum foil, just aluminum foil, and some clip leads. Lay the aluminum foil on the table and clip all of the equipment to that aluminum foil. And at the end of the field day, you wad it all up and throw it in the recycling bin, okay? That aluminum foil is a great grounding shield, not a grounding thing. It's a RF management. It allows you to manage that RF and bond it all together. And then you can connect one thing to, you know, you're using a generator. So put in a short ground rod so that you don't have, AC voltages at different points in the ground. And let me tell you a tip. Tie that big ground wire and all your extension cords to the ground wire so that nobody hooks it around the bumper of their car and drives off in the middle of the night and drags everything off of the table. Not that that's ever happened to me, but just a tip. So anyway, just use the resources that you have, aluminum foil, aluminum shielding, paneling, whatever you got. Your brother-in-law's in the roofing business, so you get him to give you some junk flashing. Okay, whatever you got. And use that to implement your version of what the military and the commercial guys do to tie all their stuff together. I use a 6-foot rack down at my station. That's my single point ground. I have everything mounted in that rack and everything ties to that. And then the rack goes out to the perimeter ground. Remember the ground rods with all the wire between it. So that's all tied together. So it's a little bit off the subject there, but that's basically what you're trying to do, is tie everything together with the resources that you've got for the frequencies at which you operate. And remember that a lot of this stuff was originally designed back in the day. I'm looking at the KWM2 behind you, back in the 50s, and most hams back in the 50s operated at 20 meters, 40 meters, 80 meters, maybe 160. Those are long wavelengths, and you can get away with all sorts of stuff that once you get up to the higher frequencies, it starts looking like an antenna. The resonant ground wire, to get back to our original topic, you run an 8-foot ground wire out to a ground rod from the back of your radio. Okay, at 80 meters, that's great. It's very short electrically. But up at 15 meters, at 10 meters, it's like about a quarter wave. And a piece of wire at a quarter wave is basically an open circuit at when it's a quarter wavelength long. Mm-hmm. It's completely disappeared. You don't have any RF ground, RF connection there at all. The wire is resonant. It's quarter wavelength long. So you have to look at all the different frequencies that you're operating at and say, what is a short single point connection at these frequencies? And if you can do it at the higher frequencies, it'll guaranteed to be working at the lower frequencies.
Right. Excellent. Well, and we've all sort of been there with the field day, and you step into the used school bus, and you know there's somebody's put down the rubber mat to make sure that you're not on the wet dewy grass, yeah, grabbing the 80 meter bus, yeah, you know, at field day. And it's amazing how much energy is transferred just in those extension cords running across the ground. You've got a big magnetic generator. Now we got inverter generators, probably a little less of that going on. But I've done field deployments, some carnival kind of work, but in the public safety realm, when you go set up a fire camp and a portable IC, the carny box, the spacing of that stuff off the ground, and you know, everybody's wondering why their GFI and their fancy comm vehicle is tripping off. Well, first of all, you shouldn't have that kind of GFI in your comm vehicle, because it's an appliance. It's not a panel. And teaching those kinds of electrical principles to people, you know, professionals who design the vehicle, as a 12 volt operated mobile vehicle, it's great. You start putting 120 volts into to a camper shell, it's a different story. And I've got a 30 foot Airstream out here. The last thing the puppies or my wife want to do is, you know, grab onto that thing, whether it's electrical or RF, and go, mm-hmm, honey, we have a problem. The trailer's hot. No, it's the air conditioner's running. It's not hot. No, the trailer's hot. You don't want that conversation with your significant other. Right.
You know, that's a neat thing about ham radio that a lot of the other services don't have to deal with. And it's one thing that makes ham radio really interesting, as long as you survive it, is that ham radio covers everything from DC to light, microwaves, every bit of it. A technician has privileges on 80 meters, 40 meters, 15 meters, all the way up to full amateur privileges up to millimeter waves. And so you learn about everything in a communication system. You learn about power supplies. You learn about grounding. You learn about bonding. You learn about RF management. You learn about lightning protection. You learn about, you know, just everything. And so when you get your ham license, the one other thing I tell students, college students in particular, is it's a great way to get practical experience in communication systems at all levels of the system, and it makes you much more valuable as a engineer, as a designer, as any kind of a technical resource when you understand and have experienced putting together a radio station that's got to work on a wide variety of frequencies all weekend long, and then you take it away. That's a great learning environment. So tell the high school kids, tell the college kids, if you want to learn about communication systems, get into ham radio and start fooling around.
Well, that's one of the keys, is that this has been my experience myself, and you see it coming from some of my Elmers only dealt with VHF and UHF, and you know, HF principles and those things weren't in their world. So we probably have to learn about all these different things. But if your focus, if you're an 80 meter guy and you treat your 2 meter, your, you know, quarter kilowatt 2 meter repeater like it's an 80 meter rig and a dipole, right, you're not going to succeed as well with that. Which is why I'm glad I've had audio experience, scientific instrumentation experience, down to the, you know, measuring, you know, pico amperes of electron signals to a 30 kilowatt broadcast FM broadcast station. You start noticing that 30 kilowatt broadcast station or 100 kilowatt TV station is built a little bit differently than the 2 meter repeater or the base station in the police station. It's a whole different thing, and you don't start to think about why that's different other than you just think sheerly the amount of power that's involved. Mm-hmm. But there's so much more of that, and those are the things we'll get into with RFI and that mitigation. I started my station here. I was a VHF UHF guy until I grandfathered into general, and somebody handed me an HF rig. And I grew up with ham radio. I was not unfamiliar with it, but I said, let me just throw that dipole out in the tree and see what happens. And the stereo started going off and squawking, and everything was. I said, all right. back to my principles here. You know how to build communication sites. Maybe I got to start doing here what R56 has suggested. And you're right. You don't have to go $7,000 worth of commercial clamps and thermite bonding and all these things.
Although thermite bonding is a lot of fun.
Oh, yeah.
I was going to throw that in. That is fun, right?
So we can do this old shack thing because I've got my rendition of R56 here, which has solved the problem. The stereo, no amount of chokes. I got a pile of ferrite cores here. You know, I'll give them away. You can spend 10 times as much on all these not the right ferrite beads that don't do anything. You can spend 10 times that amount, 10 times on that, what you would spend at Home Depot for a couple of pieces of copper pipe, some fittings, the right clamps, and a little bit of wire. And I'm sure you'll go to a garage sale or a construction site, and you can find some of those things, you know, just laying around. And you get a little creative. It might look hinky. We're hams. We can get away with some of this stuff. Mm-hmm. But those parts are around, scrap from a whole bunch of things. So
that's a great tip for the listener who has stuck with it this long. Your bonus tip for the day is when you go to the Ham Fest, don't look at the stuff on top of the table. Look at the stuff under the table. Look at the boxes and stuff that say $5, take it away. You can get hundreds of dollars worth of wire and cable and, chassis and hardware that is musty, dusty. It's been in the garage, and everybody was told to just get that stuff out of the garage. So they brought it to the HamFest, and you can have it for a song. Great stuff under the table.
See, that's one of the keys. You look at the guy and he says, well, I want $5 per ground rod. Your wife doesn't want you to bring that home, does she? A dollar a piece. Get it out of here before I have to throw it away.
I remember paying a guy 50 cents and offering to carry it to his car when I was a kid. And my mom had told me, get that stuff the heck out of the basement. So,
Yeah. So there's a lot of opportunities. I've worked in a couple of factories where the wire scrap barrel filled up all the time, and there was a lot of interesting. I got two nice oscilloscopes out of my corporate e-waste bin, and for about 5 years, I never bought a piece of wire because if I needed some coax or I needed some multi-conductor for something, out to the scrap. So it's out there.
RF doesn't care that it's, brand new or old wire. It really doesn't matter. It's that it's junk flashing or whatever. But there's one caution, and this is a good point to bring that up, about braid and using the braid from coax cables. And I used to do that. I thought that was great. You've got an old piece of junky coax, so you strip off the jacket and, take off the braid and pull it out, and you've got a nice piece of high-voltage wire and this wonderful, shiny copper thing looks like a great ground wire, right? Well, no, it's not. And the reason why not is that that braid, the way they make it is they braid it all together, and that's a fascinating thing of itself. And then they sort of do a Chinese handcuff thing onto the center wire. And that all gets pulled out by a machine, and then it goes through the liquid plastic to put the jacket on. And what the jacket does is it compresses all those wires together. If you look at them, they're just bare copper wires. The only contact between them is where they cross. And so the jacket compresses them together to hold them tight together, and it protects them from water and chemicals and oxygen. Oxygen is bad. Okay, so the minute you take that jacket off, and you've got to loosen up the braid to get it off the center conductor, all those wires start losing contact with each other, and they start corroding, and water gets into it with capillary action and all this stuff. And pretty soon, you don't have a nice, big, flat piece of braid anymore. What you have is a whole bunch of little, tiny wires that have bad connections between them.
Noise generators.
Harmonic generator, noise generator. It's just junk, okay? So don't use it for that purpose. If you want to use old coax for grounding, leave it in the jacket, okay? Just strip off the end, make a big pigtail out of it, and put a terminal on it, waterproof that braid so the water doesn't get sucked back into it, and you've got a perfectly good, big, heavy ground wire. That's great. Don't take the braid off the cable. If you absolutely have a situation like a rolling rack or something, where you have to use a flexible ground connection. Use the big, heavy, flat weave tinned strap that is sold by DX Engineering and Quicksilver and all these other vendors. You can find them, and they've got the nice terminals on each end, so you can connect them to what you need. But only use that inside. Don't use it where it can get wet or it's exposed to the weather. The standard in the military and the standard in all commercial installations is solid strap or heavy wire. Use that number 20 gauge strap. You can take flashing and you can cut it up into strips if you want, and use it if you know that's perfectly good. But solid strap or heavy wire is what you want to use. Don't reuse the braid out of coax by taking it out of the coax, although we've all done it, and it'll work for a while, but then it won't work.
Right. We've got other stories about dissimilar metals and which coax is
stories, good. Stories.
Yeah, we can go there. So we're David, how are we doing on time? I think we've exceeded our hour.
We're well past our hour, but it's going well. And I want to make sure we covered it all and we haven't missed anything.
Oh, we've covered ground systems in its entirety.
Okay.
Yeah.
Good.
We have missed a whole lot because there are the aspects of what is ground to an antenna and what has got RF value. We need to get into that because I know a lot of people will set up their HF vertical on a stake in the ground outside and think they've got a good. That gets us into RF circuits and resonant antenna and those kind of currents. That's a whole another hour and a half or 6 hours and a half.
Yeah, a ground plane is different than a ground system.
Yeah,
but see, using the same word, that ground word again, and people get confused that, it's got to be the same thing. No, it's not. It's completely different. One of the questions that came up in our pre-show was, what's an artificial ground? And an artificial ground is just another part of your antenna system that you tune to resonance so that it puts a low impedance where you want it. And that's perfectly legitimate, but it's not a ground. It's just it's like putting a weight on your tire so that the imbalance is counterbalanced by something else.
Now we're talking antennas, and
there'll be another show for that.
Another show for that. Well, that's all good. And I, in these discussions when they come up, I will mention ground plane once and get it off to radials and counterpoise, and the counterpoise as the other half of the antenna for the whole antenna currents, because I want people to start thinking that, you know, it's just like the process of an NFED. It's not a water hose. There's some back pressure that's got to go someplace. So we got worlds to discover. But I thought the getting into this ground bonding, this foundation for our currents and dissimilar voltages is a good place to start. We've got some great examples. We're going to have many, many links and drawings to illustrate this. And I'm sure what will probably have happen here is we'll get a lot of user feedback about this and questions going, well, I thought this was okay. And we can work out in resistors and voltmeter pictures where those things are going to be a problem and how to help people, you know, understand and prove that. I'm particularly keen on the differences of coverage between 80 meters and 10 meters. I don't know how many people have been bit off a 10 meter antenna on their car thinking, well, there's only 4 watts, but you know, that's why there's that little ball on the end. I'm looking to run 500 watts HF in my mobile, and there's a whole different electrical system. There's no ground on my truck. It's a counterpoise, and we can, you know, lots of expertise to start pulling into that discussion. Yeah. So I think we've only hit the tip of the iceberg, probably a third of
points.
But
the important thing is to say, look, introduce these concepts that you have to control the terms. You have to know which type of grounding you're talking about. Is it AC safety? Is it lightning protection? Are we talking about RF management? There's a whole bunch of different techniques. And then point people to references where they can learn more. And I will bring this up here.
Flash
this
that again.
This is a great
that one too.
Reference. I know we all think we know what we're doing for wiring, and we can all put in a piece of Romex and stuff. But once it gets complicated, you want to do it properly. And this is a great book. Here's a nice website for it.
Yep,
it's the best,
Amazon.
Less than $20 you'll ever spend. It shows you how to do all this stuff. Most importantly, it shows you what not to do. Like, do not use gas pipe as a ground conductor, things like that.
Really?
Well, it looks good, you know. So anyway, it's like $20. You can't go wrong. And then this is the book that ties all of the principles that we've been talking about together, and that's an ARL book.
Yeah, that's the ground.
It's like $23 or something.
Wait, hold that up one more time, right in front of your face.
Okay, here we go. Grounding and bonding. I'll try to get the.
There you go.
There. For the radio amateur, and it talks about AC safety. It talks about lightning protection. It talks about RF management. Gives some examples. There's no cookbook solution in all of this, but it'll help you build your toolbox, and it lists all the standards and things that you need to be aware of when you make a decision about how to build your stuff.
Yeah. Well, it's interesting you brought up cookbook. I do the cooking around the house, and I know how to do some things, and I went to a Tuscan cooking school for a week, and I didn't go there for recipes. I went there for how to know
technique.
Which vegetable or spice goes into what other thing. And that's
the theory of cooking.
Yeah, the theory and how to know if things are going to be compatible or not. It's chemistry just as much as amateur radio is science. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I don't want to bog people down and be in a double E, but I think we can go from a battery and a light bulb kind of current imagination to some things until you get to RF. And then we want to visualize. The human condition says, I want to see this in my mind's eye, how this RF thing works. And sometimes you can do that with an easy neck picture. Sometimes you just have to think in terms of the voltage effect around you. And lots more to cover.
Waves. Well, you have to start thinking like a wave. And you have to start thinking in terms of wavelength and, you know, electrical length and things like that. And that is a real differentiator. Again, going back to students, if you can understand how things work and visualize it in terms of RF and waves and stuff, you're a much more valuable resource to your employer than somebody who's not been exposed to that and doesn't have that RF feel. You know, people talk about the mechanics feel for how to put things together and build stuff. Well, there's an RF feel as well, and you can get that through amateur radio and just doing different things.
Yeah. And I like the concept. We've got to figure out that voltage and current are part of the power equation. And you hear a lot of people, this goes into antennas and things again, but you talk about 100-watt radio. That radio is really not putting out 100 watts unless there's something out there loading it so that there's current so that 100 watts happen. You're looking at a voltmeter, and you can't visualize power doing the damage until the voltage and current have gotten someplace to make that all happen. So those are some mysteries we'll try to illustrate and do some measurements or illustration on as we go along. Yeah. And much more into the whole RF picture as we explore antennas and balancing those things.
Yeah, as the antenna book editor, you get exposed to a tremendous amount of very diverse information, and there are some really deep experts out there that are willing to contribute what they know to these reference books that we get that are really amazing bargains. If you go out and you look at professional literature, you would pay hundreds of dollars for what you can get for $50 in an antenna book. But the challenge is to make that understandable to the average ham who does not have a deep technical background. And so how do you get people to think in terms of waves and volts and amps and phase and all this kind of stuff? It's a challenge, but It's a lifetime learning thing. So have at it, jump in.
And I hope, I hope that's what we're going to drive here. So I'm going to start wrapping us up here, 'cause I do have to go do something.
Great.
But we all, well, I've got some cooking to do.
And yeah, it's
not,
absolutely.
Not RF current.
And really
it's eating to do.
Yeah. My hope and goal here is in partnering with Jim and you two, Ward, and all the other folks that we're going to bring on, is to be able to drive these questions to expose people to stuff. Hey, I didn't know this, or I thought I knew that and I really didn't, or, hey, I even better. And, you know, make it a two-way conversation. So, you know, we're going to post this up on my show, we're going to put it up on Facebook, we're going to link it to the Amateur Radio Elmers group. And I hope that there's some dialogue back from the audience to say, hey, I got this and it was great. Or, hey, I don't completely understand this part. Or, hey, how about helping me understand this next thing that you guys didn't get to? And that really is what's going to build the community.
And we're going to get those guys to come up and say, I saw that show and you guys are full of it. Okay. I did it this way and I'm fine. Yep. And I will grab those guys and say, okay, somebody presented a problem. There's a solution here we're trying to work through. You jumped right on it and either had a solution or just said there isn't one. Let's come back into the conversation here. Just don't walk away from it, because everybody's got a different perspective of how this stuff works.
Absolutely.
And I've been pretty good through different technologies, working in you know, with chemists and medical technicians and professional engineers. I'm challenged to describe a problem to the Windows administrators I work with at work. We all have to find that common language and bring it to some understanding. And I have a lot of fun doing that. People wonder how I come up with these analogies. And so if one of them doesn't work, I'm going to make another one to tell your face goes, ah, I get it. Once the light bulb is on, we can start reading the book.
Right. And I think that's a great part of having, bringing the community together and having everybody do their thing. All right. Well, let's wrap it up here. We'll go through and introduce everybody or say goodbye. So, Ward, thank you so much for joining us.
73s, everybody. Happy bonding and enjoy yourself.
We'll look forward to having you back.
We've bonded very strongly.
Yes, absolutely. And Jim as well, thank you so much for joining and partnering with me. And I'm looking forward to more episodes and more educational opportunities. And I'm David. Thanks for joining us, folks. I'm going to give a quick pitch here. If you like what we're doing here, please visit hamradionow.tv and find Arvin, our chief financial officer, Cook the Pig, and help us out on Patreon. It is free for you to watch, but it's not free for me to make. So this has been episode number 410, ElmerCast number 1 from the ground up. Thank you all. Okay. You know how I close my show? I'm going to start it. Jim, you'll do the middle. Ward, you'll do the last part, right? This has been Ham Radio Now, over.
And out.
Okay, let's do one more time. Over.
And out.
No, you're just supposed to say one word, Jim. You got the and. Are you ready? Over.
And.
Out.
That was perfect. Okay,
wait. How do you do that with six guests?
You don't. Or some of them do them all together. It's okay.
Thanks, David. Thank you.